You see, what is fascinating about is that it involves the passage of time. When you say I am conscious, one can argue about what you mean by conscious. There's a distinction between the contents of consciousness, which is what I'm normally referring to when I talk about a space. What you've got to realize, in Einstein, with his theory of special relativity, he married up space and time. He realized that the world is four-dimensional, with the fourth dimension being time. And so, you as a human being, your body is like a world line in this. You imagine space and time in two dimensions. I hope I can use my hands, but you imagine space and time in two dimensions to make it simpler. You are like a line, your world line in this four-dimensional space, but is represented as two-dimensional space. But in Einstein's picture, it's called the block universe. Past, present, and future coexist. There is no time. But in your conscious experience, you think of yourself as moving through time. So if you imagine your world line is a brain, you sort of think of your consciousness as like a little bead which is traveling along that wire. That's your experience. So right now it's 10 to 5, but it'll be 5 o'clock in 10 minutes, and it was 4:45 minutes ago. The point is that that does not happen in relativity theory. In relativity theory, there is no passage of time. And this is well understood. And this is why many physicists and philosophers say it is an illusion. The passage of time is an illusion. And yet we all experience it. Now, what I'm saying is that mind, the experience of consciousness, is not actually part of our current picture of physics. It's not part of relativity. And nor is passage of time really in quantum theory. Time has a different status in quantum theory. So how do you explain this? Well, various philosophers have explained it, including myself, is you have to say there is an extra dimension, which is an extra dimension of time, which corresponds, if you like, to mental time as opposed to physical time. And so this is why I say current physics, meaning relativity theory and quantum theory, cannot explain the experience of consciousness. But the final theory of physics, which is going to reconcile relativity and quantum theory, that has to explain consciousness, and it has to include this extra dimension. Because what I'm saying is mental time is an extra dimension. Is that okay? Everyone's convinced? Good. Now, but there's another feature of consciousness which is really crucial. And this is to do with what I call the specious present. This is the minimum time scale of experience. You see, when we're normal human beings, there's a minimum time we can experience, which is something like a tenth of a second. You imagine my finger is a light. If I move this light around in a circle, you will see that light going round. Okay? But if it goes round too fast, if it goes round more than 10 times a second, you won't see it as motion. You'll see a continuous light. That's to do with the time scale of memory. So our experience of time only extends over a really short range of times, from something like a tenth of a second to maybe a thousand seconds. Okay? That's what we mean by human consciousness. Now, we as humans are very arrogant. We assume that that is the only level of consciousness in the universe. Humans arrogantly, I don't mean all humans, I mean a certain, especially most of my scientific colleagues, will assume that we're the most important form of consciousness. Obviously not, probably not most of you. But the question is, therefore, and couldn't work out what it was, but it turned out this flashing light was the rising and the setting of the sun. But their specious present had expanded so that it seemed to be a flashing light. It's a question of the relationship between your mental time and physical time. Now, of course, most neuroscientists would probably think that can be explained because there must be some sort of clock in time inside the brain. So, for example, one second.
Yes. Because there's a lot of things, if each one of those things, if we unpack together.
Absolutely,
it'll be
yes,
good
yes.
Because you're saying so many things, we will. Important thing is, I think Einstein is committing incest.
Yeah.
When he says we will marry time and space. I don't know whether he said it or not. Yeah. You said. Because what we are seeing as space, in my experience, is a consequence of time. Time has given birth to space. And our sense of time is essentially because of cyclical moments, otherwise we don't know time. Right now people are sitting here, well, if this goes for an hour and a half, two, they're okay. It doesn't matter what great truths you talk, if it becomes 4 hours, they will slowly slip out.
Yeah.
Because not the clock, their bladder keeps time.
Yeah.
Their backside keeps time. Mm-hmm. Their lower back keeps time. Suppose they didn't have a body, we took away their bodies, Then if we sat here for 2 million years, they have no problem. We as physical beings are a consequence of time, which is essentially cyclical movements of physical material. We are a consequence of that. If we rise above our physicality, there is no sense of time in us. This is what, unfortunately, the Western observers are saying is trance. Somebody has risen above his physical state. Now, he sits here, you think he's sitting here whatever number of days, but he, in his experience, he's sitting for a few moments. It's a living experience for me in my life. Then there are any number of people who've gone into deeper processes where if you make them sit in a certain state, they don't know any sense of time, time just like that. So, how much impact, when I said you can either get crushed by time or you can be trapped by time or you can be liberated by riding the time, how deeply you're identified with your physicality, that's how much power time has over you. If you're not so physically identified, now you're a scientist, you're a lot happening up there, now you go into your laboratory or wherever you go, you don't know when to eat. There are some people, their stomach tells them all the time when to eat, when to go to the bathroom, when they should go again. In the office, you will see many of them in 8 hours of work are going to the bathroom 4 to 5 times and going to eat and drink another 5 times because completely ruled by the body. If suddenly you became more interested in something else, you don't know when to eat, when to pee, when not to do, because bodily influence on you, the power of the body is gone. Once the power of the body is gone on you, the power of time is gone on you. So if you're completely free from that, you're beyond time process. But how do we come to this? We look at human body as a construct like this. There is a physical body, which is an accumulation of the food that we have eaten. This is the hardware that we built. There is a software which you're calling as a mental space, is it? I'm sorry, mental space. It's a mental body, we call that also as body. We're calling everything body, all the 5 aspects we call it as body because body means you can observe, you can learn. Space is a vague thing. So there is a mental body, there is memory and information and intelligence right across. So the mental body, this is the software. Hardware, software together can do nothing unless it's plugged into power. So the third layer, we call this as the pranamaya kosha or the energy body. So it's plugged in and these things are functioning.